Welcome back to the Mark Skoda Show. This is your host, Mark Skoda. We're joined by several guests today from France, and we're going to be talking about the center-right coalition and some of the political initiatives going on today in the country. You know, we've actually had our co-chair, Rosine Garouage, who has been in the French initiatives there with the Tea Party movement. And Rosine has met a number of the guests there, and we're looking forward to having a conversation. We have online with us today Jean Robin, who is a journalist as well as the editor of Tatamis, which is a book company. Guy Millieu, who is a writer and also journalist. He has written a number of books, including The Resistible Ascension of Barack Obama. We'll look forward to talking to him about that. As well as the president of RPF France, who is Nicolas Stoker, who is actually a good friend on my Facebook account. We've communicated regularly, and we're going to welcome them to the Mark Skoda Show, gentlemen.
Good afternoon, Mark. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, and good evening to you all. I appreciate you joining us today. And, well, look, let's get right to it. You know, there are a lot of very interesting developments in the country of France, in particular, as we've begun to see a movement towards a center-right political confluence of various candidates and, in fact, in the French body politic. Is that right?
That's right.
And have you, I guess, what is causing this right now? I mean, we've seen, of course, the relationship between Sarkozy and Obama strained at some times, but, of course, with the alliance in NATO and the Libya action, it seemed to have come together more clearly. But more importantly, it seems that the country, while there is still a very strong socialist social left, also is beginning to evolve new parties on the right. In fact, the Parti Républicain, as well as other the Gaullist Party reforming, and many of the center-right and far-right coalitions seem to be working more closely together.
If compared with the American situation, I could say that we don't really have a conservative movement in France right now. I could say that if you look at what Sarkozy is doing, I could say that he's closer to Obama positions than what you hear coming from the Republican Party or from the Tea Parties. So I think that it's one of the reasons why so many people in France feel frustrated. We don't have a conservative movement anymore. We don't have classical liberal. We don't have the ideas that I hear when I listen to the primary Republican debates. These ideas have completely disappeared from the intellectual and the political field in France. And I think that what Nicolas wants to do is to rebuild something going in this direction. Because when a country is full of socialist party or fake conservative parties, the situation is not very good, and people feel lost. We have many, many troubles in France right now, economical problems, social problems, and we cannot find a solution to these problems because nobody speaks about the solutions that are evoked in Great Britain, in Canada, in the English-speaking world, in the United States.
You know, it's interesting because, of course, a lot of people watched as France began to respond in almost a knee-jerk way to the outlawing, for instance, of veils in school. It seemed, from a perspective as an American and having lived in Europe a long time, it seemed almost as a reaction to the dilution of French nationality. And it was rather than a understanding of the real problems of frankly, immigration that was never controlled. Is that the case?
It's not completely the case. I could say that the law about the veil and the ban of the Muslim veil in France is just a political movement trying to show we do something. But in fact, the politicians in France do nothing about that. They mostly try to show they do something, but it changes nothing to what the people have in their minds. So it's impossible to have a debate in France right now about Islam and about the rise of the Islamic movements in France. So they say, we ban the burqa, we ban the veil. But in fact, if I go to see my daughter at school, I see that you have more and more mothers who are completely veiled. You see their face, that's right, but you don't see the rest, and they don't integrate. They try to be aside, to be apart from society, and you have more and more women like that. You have more and more Muslim men wearing beards and wearing Muslim garbs and all that. And so we are under a heavy Muslim influence in France right now, and it's not vanishing, not at all. Nothing changed. So the politicians behave as if they were doing something, but it's just as if.
Right, and it's sort of, we would refer to that as kabuki theater. It was sort of only to put a visual element to the real, without actually addressing the real problem, which is the Islamification of some parts of France. We saw this in some sense a few summers ago when we saw the riots and the burning of cars. It seems to be a major problem throughout Europe today, but France is unable to deal with this because the party affiliations, particularly the lack of a conservative movement, seems to allow many of the political leadership to sort of bump along without actually taking strong decisions. Is that right?
That's right. And I think that more and more politicians are afraid to take decisions because they are scared by the risk of riots. They know that you have more and more Muslims who can vote. And when you know that you have, for example, 5 million of Muslims who can vote, it means that if you do something that unpleasant for Muslims, you don't take that decision. You speak about that in private, but you don't speak about it in public.
And if I can add something, Mark, is the fact that as soon as you criticize Islam, you're considered a racist or a far right or whatever they want to call you.
Right.
So that's really the role of the media here. And I realized this long time ago that the media have taken over the main power in France without any votes. You know, that there's been no election to elect the media here. But if you take their ideology, they're mostly socialist and pro-Islam and politically correct in general. So how can you fight this? Well, trying to build new medias, and that's what we're trying to do with Internet, thanks to the U.S. who created Internet, but as you know, it's quite difficult.
Well, Guy, you know, I think you're exactly where the Tea Party has been here in this country. Remember, they have the left has used the branding of racism and even terrorists on the Tea Party, suggesting that because we march, because we are focusing on responsible government, suddenly we are antagonistic to people of color and antagonistic to American values, which is not the case. You know, we have today in our country, as you probably have seen, the Occupy Wall Street, the Occupy Name Your City, which is a ragtag band of people without very much focus. And like you in France, you know, we have had to evolve our new media outlets, our bloggers. We've had to build our new media papers. We've had to obviously use the Internet and Facebook and social media to help begin to communicate. And this is what has been a critical element in, I believe, the Tea Party not only ascending but also fielding candidates, and as we saw in 2010, having a major impact on elections. How do you, this center-right coalition that you know we've talked about with Rosine before, when she was in Lyon, is rather new. It's nascent. Do you see some of the politicians beginning to sort of perhaps not look at the political power, but look at how they can work together on the right, center-right to the far-right, and figure out how they are more effective? Would that be something that's beginning to happen, Guy?
I think that it's starting to happen, but it's very, very difficult because in France you don't have the freedom of speech, you don't have free speech. If you say something too clearly, you can be sued and you can be in front of a tribunal. And the media in France try to scare everybody. As Jean was saying, when you say something bad about Islam, they say that you are a fascist. If you say that you support the United States in general, and if you support the Tea Parties, you're a fascist too. If you support Israel, you're a fascist. Everybody on the right is supposed to be a fascist for many newspapers and media, mainstream media in France. And I think that what's happening in the United States is very interesting. It will be interesting you know, Herman Cain is very strong in the Republican primaries. He's black, completely black. Obama is half black only. And he's supported by the Tea Parties. And it will be very, very difficult for French journalists to explain how the racist Tea Parties can support a black businessman.
Right, exactly. And look, you know, I lived in Europe for about 6 years in Germany, England, and actually Belgium, and worked heavily in France. Actually, I worked in mergers and acquisitions and bought a company called Prost Transports in France, the Prost family. You may know Alain Prost, the race car driver.
Yes.
And France is a very interesting place because on one side, there is this sense by the people that I observe that is all about big government and the social welfare state, but the country is made up of enormous amounts of entrepreneurs and small shop owners and people who are trying to make a living, but frankly seem to be held back by the government, the very government they're looking to help them.
Yes, I think you're right. I think that in order to be a businessman or a small entrepreneur in France, you have to be a kind of hero. Because you're harassed constantly by the government, by the French IRS, and by bureaucrats on every side. You have to pay heavy taxes. So it's very, very hard for these people. But the main problem we have, and I hope that the United States will not have the same problem soon because of Obama, that more than 50% of the French population don't pay taxes at all. So it's very easy for politicians to be supported by people who are ready to ask for more taxes coming from wealthy people.
Well, you know, it's interesting you should make that point because, indeed, for the first time in this country, 51% of Americans pay no income tax. In fact, almost 37% receive a check from the federal government. We've already reached that tipping point, and when we talk about America becoming a social welfare state like Europe, we're actually much closer than most people believe. This is why this interview, I think, is important to understand that as we cede our liberties through giving up more and more of our wealth to more from fewer and fewer people to more who wish to demand checks, to demand benefits, eventually we also lose our liberty. We lose our ability to speak, as you point out. We can be charged with inciting antagonism. One of the things that the Tea Party has done very well here, though, I would say, and perhaps a way in which the center-right and right coalition that might be formed there over time, is to say what you are for and to focus on those things that you are trying to change rather than be antagonistic, for instance, to immigration or antagonistic to the social welfare state. It's about being for smaller government. It's about being for national identity. And those are ways in which, certainly even in our own country here in America, the Tea Party has been somewhat effective. Do you see that as being a way forward, perhaps, in France?
Yes, indeed, Mark. And by the way, it's interesting that you say so, because in France we've realized that maybe it's the key to the future of our country. No less than this, and that's why I've tried to gather different parties, different organizations, associations, intellectuals, and journalists to think about how could we gather on positive thinking and construction of a new, if not movement, at least a new coalition of interest. And on the 3rd of December, we will be gathering all these people to try to see what's their opinion on the subject, and it's definitely not a party coalition, nor a meeting, but a kind of a network. We've called it the Network of Free Frenchmen, and we would like you maybe to join us on the 3rd of December, if you may, because we would be really honored to have somebody from the Tea Party movement.
Well, I'd be honored to do so. I think I could offer some insights, and particularly since. Although my French is not very good, my German is very good. But I certainly would be honored to be there and join you and talk about what happened in this movement and certainly understanding from an American's point of view, having lived and worked in Europe extensively. I think what's interesting about what's happening in France, and as I've watched Sarkozy sort of go back and forth, and you know, on one side it seemed he was moving more to a center-center-right presidency, but then he is, I believe, by circumstance, and his own weakness in the country has moved back to center left and towards big government and indeed towards interventionist policies, as he's done in Libya. Successfully, I agree, but nonetheless, to the distraction of what the country is looking to do, it seems to me. And I think it's important. The one observation I would make, and I'll ask you to comment, is that in France, the parties have always looked at trying to drive towards winning seats, and they have not worked well together, particularly the center-right and the right-leading parties. And this, I see, has been one of the big problems in forming these coalitions. So I applaud you for pulling together this idea, at least to begin to have people talking.
Exactly.
One of the problems we have is that we don't have primaries like you have in the United States. So in general, in France, it's the political parties who choose the candidates. And so you have the same candidates for 20, 30 years. You don't have a renewal of the politicians. You could not see somebody like Herman Cain appear on the French stage, for example. So we are blocked in many ways. And I think it's important to explain what's happening with the Tea Parties to people in Europe. And I think it's important, too, for Europeans to explain to Americans in Tea Parties. I did it giving lectures to several Tea Parties in the United States to explain what happens when you lose your liberty and when you go too far in the socialist direction. When you go too far in this direction, your liberty is lost, your freedom is lost, and people are ready to live on subsidies coming from the state, and everything becomes blocked, and you lose your country. And I think that it's very important to explain that, because many Americans don't see exactly what Obama is trying to do. And I think that what Obama is trying to do is to create a welfare state in the United States that will go as far as we have gone in Europe, and that if he succeeds, the United States will get bankrupt, completely bankrupt, as we are in Europe.
Well, and this is exactly where we are today. I mean, we have a president, as you know, and we are antagonistic to his policies because he has, in his three short years, increased our very debt by over almost $5 trillion U.S. dollars. And of course, we are no longer better off than we were even 4 years ago. The interesting thing, there was a World Bank review of the best places to start entrepreneurial new businesses. The United States didn't even make it in the top 10. Interesting, and in fact, the only European, quote-unquote, countries that made it are the former republics of the Soviet Union. Georgia, Belarus, even Rwanda, Hong Kong, Singapore. It was amazing to me to read this, and it I think, indicates the fundamental problem in our Western countries that have begun to evolve towards this social welfare statism. We have therefore provided extraordinary amounts of legislation and regulation, which even restricts the needed incentive for societies to renew themselves. And so you end up with a Greece and perhaps an Italy and Spain and Portugal and Ireland, and France and Germany are left to pick up the bill. But even those countries with the large economies of France and Germany are insufficient to finally pay, as we say, the tab when it comes due.
That's right. And I could say that Europe is in the way of committing suicide because we have less and less babies, more and more old people. And so in some European countries, these countries lose population right now. I think that in Germany, they start to lose 500,000 people a year, and it will go like that for years and years. In Italy, it's the same. In Spain, it's the same. And the only people who make babies in these countries are mostly Muslim migrants. And so it will change the composition of the population, and it will create one more disaster. You have an economical disaster, a political disaster, but you will have a demographical disaster, too.
Do you know, it's
interesting. Mark,
yes, go ahead.
Can I answer your question another way?
Please.
The question you asked about the difference with France. I think we had in our history, the last 40 years, we had a political party called the National Front, which has done a lot of harm to this country, and especially to the Patriots. Because as soon as you were defending your country, you were called a Nazi simply because the main patriotic party in France was the National Front, with at its head an anti-Semitic guy called Jean-Marie Le Pen, and his daughter called Marine Le Pen will be meeting with the Tea Party movement, it seems, in the days to come. And I'm just not sure that the American people are aware that she's at the left of Obama. She's saying it herself, you know.
Right.
And she's for a strong state, and I don't know what she's gonna do with the Tea Parties, because she's got nothing to do with them, to my knowledge.
Guy, let me. We're gonna take a quick break here, and then we're gonna come back and finish up the interview. I've got to go to a break, and I'll be right back. This is Mark Skoda, the Mark Skoda Show. We have our friends from France with us, and we'll be right back after this short break. Welcome back to the Mark Skoda Show. This is your host, Mark Skoda. We have our guests from the country of France, the center-right coalition, Jean Robin, Guy Meyer, and Nicolas Stocker, who is also the president of the RPF France, a Gaullist movement, center-right. You know, folks, we're trying to give you a perspective. We often talk about in this country, in America, how Barack Obama and the left are trying to move us towards a social welfare state, much like Europe. And most Americans don't understand what that truly means. In trying to give you perspectives here, you can realize how much of our liberty we give up when we move that way. Guy, I want to talk to you because you've also written a couple of books, how the Palestinian people were sort of created, essentially formed, if you will. You've written about the U.S. and the world after Bush. You've written, of course, the book, The Resistible Ascension of Barack Obama. And one other thing that's been very interesting to me that was reported in Rue 89 was this issue around the American embassy and the consulate actually working to lift up minorities, and in particular Muslims. And why would the American State Department be doing that in the country of France, a sovereign state? I was confounded by this article and the details relating to actually comments by our American, not ambassador, but State Department folks who are there in France.
I agree completely with you. And I haven't heard about that for more than 6 months. And I think that it's coming from the fact that the State Department under Obama think that France and other European countries will become more and more Muslim. And so they want to show to Muslims that they support them, that they are ready to accept a more Muslim Europe, and to have connections with these Muslims, and to support them in what they are trying to do politically. They are ready to support a Muslim politically correct movement in Europe. And I think that it's connected to the fact that the Obama administration is very close to Islam. And I think that you could see it when Obama spoke in Cairo. I think that it's what I say in the next book I'm writing about Obama. It will be called The Obama Disaster. And I think that Obama wants to make the Middle East safer for radical Islam and Europe safer for Islam. And I think that we are on this way now.
It seems to me, and of course, as I've pointed on this show numerous times, you know, with the Arab Spring, we have in Egypt Christians being killed by the hundreds. We know that in Libya, black Africans, mostly Christians, were jailed. We know that in Afghanistan, I think there's one Jew left. The intolerance of the Islamic nations, and this is what also confounds us. And as I look at this, I was reading quotes by Mark Shapiro, and also back from 2005, the ambassador Craig Stapleton, who seemed to think of this as, well, you know, we've got to have a more diverse relationship in our Western nations. But this is absolutely disallowed in every other Islamic nation. I do not understand how our tolerance is so high for those who would frankly kill us.
That's right. This tolerance is one way, and it's not the other way. And you don't have a Muslim spring, you don't have an Arab spring, you have an Islamic winter. If you see what's happening in Egypt, you're right. In Egypt, the Copt has chased. They are killed. The churches are burned. It's the same in Iraq. I think it risks to be the same in Syria. And I think that what's happening in Libya is not clear at all. I see that the people who have the arms are people who had connections with Al-Qaeda in the past, and so I'm afraid it will be worse than under Gaddafi. I had to see what's happened, but it's what I think. And I think that you will have elections in Tunisia, and I think that the main party in Tunisia will be another, and that's an Islamic party. So it's really an Islamic winter that is starting, and I think that many journalists are blind and they don't want to see it.
What do you, I mean, are you beginning to reach out as, I mean, you know, this is a nascent center-right coalition, people like yourselves who are not antagonistic. I mean, you love your country like I love my country. You believe in liberty, and I mean, you know, we Alain de Tocqueville, of course, when he observed America, one of your great French writers, clearly understood how wonderful and free America is. But we seem to be wanting to shackle ourselves and to be more like the Europeans. I love Europe. I live there. I found the people to be charming in all in every way, and I try to be a good American citizen of the world. Having said that, in 85, when the Berlin Wall, you know, was still there, and some years later when it went down, I've seen a movement more towards, frankly, restricting of people's rights in particular Western Europe. And it seems to me that there must be a movement to break out from that. And, you know, are you working across borders with Germans and Italians and Spanish and others in trying to create that, or are you just really focusing today on France alone?
I think it would be important to create a movement that would cover all Europe. And I think that it would be important to have ties with other Western countries, because I think that we are in the same boat. We are confronted to the same situation. And what is very dangerous, according to me, in Europe right now, is that you have less and less people who understand the United States, who love the United States. And I think that it's bad, because I think that the United States and Europe are, as I said, in the same boat. And we have to fight together to support our civilization, because we have the same rules, we have the same aim, we have the same definition of liberty, and I could add to that, too, that we have to support Israel. And I see that in Europe you have less and less people who support Israel. When you say that you support Israel and that you support the United States, especially conservatives in the United States, you're considered as a bad man. And I think it creates a dangerous situation. It's almost impossible to have people who are conservative, who support the United States and who support Israel in the same time. If you do all that, you're almost like a dissident in the former Soviet Union.
Yeah. And Mark, definitely on the 3rd of December, when you will come over, you have foreign people as well. You have hopefully German. You have certainly English people. There'll be lots of French, of course. And, well, by the way, Nicolas Stocker, who's next to me, wanted to say something about this meeting.
Please.
We are introducing Nicolas Stocker. Nicolas Stocker is the new president of RPF, the new Rassemblement pour la France, which is trying to build a new political party that is based on the old French Gaullist party, and is very pleased to have the contact with the Tea Party. It's very difficult in France to succeed, to create a space conservative, because of the French mentality. Nicolas Stocker said that we will need to unite all the people from the old Europe and from the United States in order to save both countries We need the people that have a lot of common sense, that love their country and have healthy ID, like M. Guy Millière and Jean Robert. The Conservative Party will start in France. It's very hard to start a party because with the French conservative movement start to have an influence in France. And we are trying to regroup the people together in order to find a common will for conservatism, old French value, defense of freedom.
Well, look, I appreciate your time tonight. This is we're going to do this more often. I really think, and I appreciate the invite on December 3rd. I will, first of all, look forward to that. I think we will hopefully do a number of interviews. I'll be taping and broadcasting this for my listening audience. We also will replay this interview on our Saturday show. We are, you know, where we also are in quite a number of affiliates. I think it's important we continue this dialogue, and I think the Tea Party here in America, and I think Americans generally, have to realize how this center-right movement, even in Europe, is gaining ground. And yes, it's a much harder task because of the limitations on speech, the limitations on some liberties that we take for granted here. But America, if it doesn't wake up to these realities and understand what it means to be a social welfare state and to recognize, as you've so well expressed, the challenges both to the body politic and to people generally, then we will be losing our liberties and our very nature as Americans.
You're completely right.
It's good to hear that.
I appreciate your time this evening. We're going to go ahead and wrap the interview up, and then I'll look forward to meeting you all on December 3rd, and we will also provide a copy of this replay for you as well.
Thanks so very much, Mark. We'll be looking forward to hearing from you.
Gentlemen, thanks so very much.
Thank you very much.
Merci.
Looking forward to meeting you.
Thank you so much.
Merci, Marc. Merci, Rosine.
Merci beaucoup. Au revoir.
Au revoir.